Good evening. I'm Judy Woodruff on the NewsHour tonight. Unsealed, a newly public warrant and receipt for the search of Mar-a-Lago reveal that FBI agents retrieved top secret documents from former President Trump's home. Then, 5 years later, Charlottesville, Virginia reckons with the trauma caused by a deadly white supremacist rally and questions whether the nation has made any progress in rooting out extremism.
I had hoped that the Unite the Right rally would light a fire and urge Charlottesville to become a model. And I think we still have that hope, but I don't think we're there yet.
And it's Friday. David Brooks and Jonathan Capehart weigh in on the investigations surrounding Donald Trump and primary victories by his supporters who are election deniers. All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Pediatric Surgeon, Volunteer, Topiary Artist, a Raymond James Financial Advisor, Taylor's advice to help you live your life. Life well planned.
And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the NewsHour, including Jim and Nancy Bilton, and Kathy and Paul Anderson.
The John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, fostering informed and engaged communities. More at kf.org.
And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
A federal judge has unsealed and made public the search warrant for former President Donald Trump's Mar-a-Lago estate. A review of the warrant and a list of items removed from Trump's property reveals that the FBI collected over 20 boxes of items, binders of photos, as well as handwritten correspondence on Monday. Some of those items were classified as top secret, information that should never be outside of a secure government facility. The former president did not oppose the unsealing of the documents, and in a statement released today, he asserts that he not only declassified the information, but also that the lengths the FBI went to search his property were not necessary. In his words, quote, "All they had to do was ask." We want to bring in one of the reporters who initially broke the story today. She's Sadie Gurman of the Wall Street Journal and former federal prosecutor Renato Mariotti. Hello to both of you. Thank you for joining us. Sadie Gurman, let me start with you just to clarify this. Which government agency was looking for these documents or material?
So this all started when the National Archives notified the Justice Department that within about 15 boxes it had collected from Mar-a-Lago after Trump left the White House was some serious national security information. So they referred they referred the matter to the Justice Department for investigation. And that has sort of prompted this incredible back and forth that we are seeing, which culminated this week in the search and in the release of the search warrant. So ultimately, the Justice Department came looking for any sort of remaining classified documents that were at Mar-a-Lago, and they found quite a few, as the warrant that we saw today revealed.
And so there's been a lot thrown around about what was in these documents. What is known about what was there? For example, nuclear information about nuclear weapons. What is known about what was found?
So we actually know, very little from this warrant in and of itself. But what we do know is that there were 11 sets of classified documents contained within these boxes, and some of which were considered top secret and openable only in a very secure government facility. That classification pertains to things like military secrets, defense secrets, information that would be critical to our national security interests. So certainly something like nuclear information would be classified at that level. But the search warrant itself does not actually detail what is inside of those boxes, but it offers some pretty tantalizing glimpses into what investigators are looking at and what they will be poring over for the next few weeks.
And Sadie Gurman, what's known about why they had to do this? Because as we just reported, the former president is saying he had declassified these documents, and he also went on to say all they had to do was ask. So which was it?
Well, what we certainly, you know, the former president's team is portraying this as a heavy-handed and aggressive move by the Justice Department. But to the federal prosecutors who have been working to try to get this information, the search was a culmination of a month-long effort to get, get returned this material after several steps in which they tried to get it and then still believe that there was more classified information contained on the premises. We know that that they had been in negotiations with the Trump team, and that in June, the Justice Department filed a subpoena to get still more classified information out of the president's private club. And then after that, we know that there was somebody familiar with the storage of these papers who believed that there was still more classified information at Mar-a-Lago that had not been retrieved and that the president and his staff were still holding on to there. So from the Justice Department's standpoint, this was the end result of a lot of hard work to get these documents back. From the Trump team's perspective, they were saying, we were cooperating. Why are you taking right. this sort of aggressive approach?
And Renato Mariotti, from what we know, what can we say about whether DOJ, Department of Justice, and FBI followed procedures as they should have in doing all this?
It appears to me that they not only followed procedures, but they actually went the extra mile to be accommodating to the former president. I will say that if there was top secret classified documents in my home or in your home, I don't think we would have had the lengthy discussions, subpoena, and some of the discussions that Sadie had. None of that would happen. There would be no polite conversation. I do think there would be an execution of a search warrant much earlier down the line.
And Renato Mariotti, the reporting, what we see from this receipt is that they list three possible criminal violations: the Espionage Act, an obstruction statute, and the law against destruction or altering of documents. So what does that tell us that they were looking for?
Well, I think the most interesting of the group is 1519, what you dubbed the obstruction statute. That one, ordinarily, what I would suggest, if I saw that on a search warrant, I would think that actually the Justice Department was looking for evidence of obstruction of justice, was looking for example, the concealment of records that might actually be inculpatory in some way. I've charged the statute when I was a federal prosecutor. I've seen it in private practice since. And that's usually what it means. However, I mean, it is a broad statute, and I think one of the questions we have to be asking here is whether or not they are using that statute in a broader sense because they really just wanted to get that information back in government hands.
And I think the question on everyone's mind is, what does this mean, Renato Mariotti, in terms of whether the former president could be charged with some criminal violation?
I think it means, I'd say a couple of things. First of all, I think there's certainly a possibility that the Justice Department's focus here is merely to get these documents back, as it was explained by Sadie just a moment ago, very important secret documents that the government would want to have in its possession. However, if they wanted to go forward and bring charges, this is much more plausible and, frankly, stronger than many of the potential legalities that are bandied about regarding the former president. And it's simply because there are not a lot of good reasons why one would have this information. It would be very difficult to explain to a jury why you had this information. And the run-up to the execution of the search warrant, all the discussions between the former president's team and the Justice Department would actually help to prove the state of mind. In other words, to undercut the defense you had shown a moment ago, Judy, where he said if you wanted the documents, all I had to do is ask. Of course, they did ask the former president's team, and if he tried to point the finger at them, he would have to waive privilege in order to do so.
Well, that's what I want. I want to ask you, Renato Mariotta, the same question I asked Sadie Gurman, and that is, is there a way we can know to what extent the Trump team was cooperating and to what extent they were resisting requests to turn over this information? We're getting two completely different stories here.
Well, we can just use some common sense, okay? And the common sense is that the Justice Department, if the reporting is accurate by Sadie and others, there was some discussions in a subpoena before the search warrant was executed. If the Justice Department had everything that they needed before the search warrant was executed, they would have never needed to bother with the search warrant. And when they executed the search warrant, there would have been nothing to find. So I think on its face, it's apparent that the cooperation was not where it needed to be from the former president and his team.
And Sadie Gurman, just quickly back to you. You mentioned it. They'll be looking at this these documents for a few weeks. What are you hearing about how long it may take for them to go through and see what's here?
Well, if we've seen anything from this Justice Department, is that they're very meticulous and deliberative. And I think that this is just the start of what is sure to be a very long and ongoing investigation. And I think that they will be poring over these documents for some time and trying to figure out what they have and, you know, whether they need to mitigate any sort of losses in terms of what's been out there. So I think that they're just getting started and we have been given a pretty, you know, a significant glimpse, but yet at the same time, kind of a small one into what all, you know, that they'll be looking at and considering in the weeks to come.
Sadie Gurman of The Wall Street Journal, Renato Mariotti, former federal prosecutor. Thank you both.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Vanessa Ruiz in for Stephanie Tsai with NewsHour West. We'll return to the full program after the latest headlines. House lawmakers gave final approval to the Inflation Reduction Act. Opponents of the $700 billion climate, health care, and tax package claim it would increase overall spending and worsen inflation. But Democrats insist neither is true and that it will bring much-needed relief.
I am proud that we are finally allowing drug prices to be negotiated to lower those costs. I'm proud that we are extending the biggest expansion in health care coverage in a decade. I'm proud that we are reducing future energy costs for thousands of families.
Democrats believe they can spend their way out of inflation and tax their way out of recession. It will only make the suffering Americans face today that much worse. This bill is simple. It is welfare for the wealthy environmentalists and big corporations.
The legislation now goes to President Biden for his signature. Meanwhile, stocks rallied on Wall Street today to notch their fourth straight winning week and to make the longest winning streak since November 2021. The Dow Jones Industrial Average surged 424 points to close at 33,761. The Nasdaq rose 267 points and the S&P 500 added 73. Award-winning author Salman Rushdie was attacked on stage today before a lecture at the Chautauqua Institution in Western New York. Police said Rushdie was stabbed in the neck and then airlifted to a hospital for surgery. This evening, Rushdie's agent said the author is currently on a ventilator with a damaged liver and severed nerves in an arm. He also said that Rushdie is likely to lose an eye. Video showed the suspected attacker, identified as Hadi Mukhtar of New Jersey, being led away as people tried to help Rushdie. Mukhtar was later taken into custody.
It's very early. We don't have any indication of a motive at this time, but we are working with the FBI, the sheriff's office, and we will determine what the cause of this was or what the motive for this attack was. Yeah, we have no indication that there were any previous threats.
Rushdie was the target of an Iranian death warrant back in 1989 after his book The Satanic Verses was banned in Iran for blasphemy. Health officials said today the polio virus has been detected in New York City's sewage water, suggesting local transmission. That comes just weeks after a case of the disease, which causes paralysis and even death, was identified north of the city. Now, officials are urging people to get vaccinated, especially children. In Ukraine, shelling continued overnight at the Zaporizhzhia nuclear power plant, despite warnings from UN officials of a potential nuclear disaster. Further east in Kramatorsk, children watched as people cleared debris from 11 Russian rockets that reportedly rained down on the town overnight. Residents were left to pick up the pieces.
I'm afraid if I leave, I won't have a place to go back to, as everything will be destroyed. The youth have hopes to buy or build something. At my age, I can't afford myself anything.
Meanwhile, a UN transport ship docked in Ukraine today that will bring more than 23,000 metric tons of grain to Ethiopia. It is the first such delivery to Africa after months of Russian blockades. Also, massive wildfires are raging out of control in southwestern France. The fire in the Gironde region and neighboring Landes region has been fueled by dry, scorching weather. 10,000 people were forced to evacuate. More than 300 firefighters from across Europe have joined 1,000 French firefighters to battle the flames that have burned 29 square miles since Tuesday. And all of this comes as an unprecedented drought is gripping nearly half of Europe, damaging agriculture, forcing water restrictions, and threatening species. Water levels on the Rhine River in Germany could reach a critically low point in the coming days, which would cause major issues transporting coal and gasoline.
For shipping, of course, the depth of the fairway is crucial. It determines how much a ship can load. If you compare this with the last few years, the water levels are exceptionally low.
Experts say they fear Europe is on track to have its worst drought in 500 years. And all of this as seasonal flooding in eastern Sudan has destroyed more than 2,500 homes there. United Nations officials estimate some 38,000 people there have also been affected by the flooding. Still to come on the News Hour, Charlottesville reckons with the violence wrought by a mob of white supremacists 5 years ago today. The United States lead negotiator discusses the prospects for reviving the Iran nuclear deal. And David Brooks and Jonathan Cabehart weigh in on the week's political headlines and much more.
This is the PBS News Hour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
In response to the FBI search at Mar-a-Lago, some Trump supporters have also increased calls for a civil war. Laura Barrón-López takes a deeper look at threats of political violence by elements of the far right.
Those dangerous threats are being fueled by conspiracy theories, as well as the mistrust of the FBI and Justice Department that has been promoted by many Republican politicians. To explain the rising extremism on the right, we're joined by Barbara Walter, professor at University of California at San Diego and author of the book, How Civil Wars Start. Barbara, thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
I want to ask you about the Mar-a-Lago search prompted a lot of Trump supporters to call for civil war. How does this fit into the growing pattern of extremism on the right?
So for those of us who study violent extremism here in the United States, this is not a surprise at all. If you had been on the chat rooms starting in 2008, you would have seen an increasing narrative that talked about shifting to a more violent strategy if more conventional methods of maintaining power, and by that I mean white power here in this country, didn't work. And so what we're seeing is sort of that narrative moving into the mainstream.
And yesterday, a gunman breached an FBI office in Cincinnati, Ohio, before being killed by authorities. Reports said that he appeared to be at the January 6th insurrection, and he had also previously said he wanted to attack the FBI. When you see these incidents connected to violent rhetoric, what does that say to you?
Yeah. So we know that violent extremism here in the United States has increased consistently since 2008, and it continues to increase quite dramatically. We know that much of the violence is being perpetrated by far-right groups, and we know the profile of those far-right groups. About 65% of them are white supremacist groups. About 29% of them are anti-federal government groups, and there's overlap there. But the anti-federal government groups are groups that think that the federal government is illegitimate. If they see it as legitimate, that it has too much power. And the reason they don't want the federal government to have too much power is that federal law overrides state law. And so what we're seeing is an increase in attacks on law enforcement agents and on federal government employees. And so, of course, the gunman in Cincinnati was targeting the FBI, and that's no coincidence. And I'll say one more thing, that there is a book called The Turner Diaries, and it's considered the Bible of the far right. The Turner Diaries outlines exactly how you would persecute, conduct a civil war against the U.S. government. And the very first thing it says that you should do is to attack the FBI.
Speaking of distrust of institutions, House Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy has said that if Republicans take control of the House, they will investigate Attorney General Merrick Garland. And a number of other Republicans have said that the FBI should be simply destroyed. What signal does that send to the Republican base?
Well, that signals to them that these organizations are illegitimate, that are somehow corrupted, that don't deserve to exist. And when you get to the point where you begin to believe that, then your trust in democracy and your belief that democracy should continue to exist evaporates. So this is exactly a strategy that a would-be autocrat or a strongman would want to pursue.
Mm-hmm. And then also, in response to this FBI search, there are some who are arguing that prosecuting former President Trump will absolutely result in a civil war and therefore a breakdown of democracy. But would impunity for Trump embolden the same forces calling for that civil war?
Well, I don't believe that prosecuting President Trump is going to be a trigger for civil war, and that's because we know what the triggers of civil war are. And the triggers tend to be things that bring a loss of hope to the base of supporters. And a loss of hope usually comes from a series of losses at elections. So if a group that thinks it deserves to be in power loses one election, then loses a second election, then loses a third election, they begin to lose hope that they will ever come to power again. That's when you tend to see a shift towards violence. So former President Trump is no longer in power. There's going to be an election in 2024. A Republican candidate is going to run for power. And if that Republican wins that election, there's going to be a resurgence of hope amongst the base. And we're going to see less risk of civil war rather than more.
And then very quickly, Barbara, you served on a CIA-led task force that studied political instability and violence. That task force was not able to study the U.S. Should the U.S. be studied under a similar task force, and how would that be done?
Yeah. Well, first of all, I should be clear that the CIA should absolutely never study the United States. It is an agency designed to gather intelligence on countries outside the United States. We do not want the CIA looking at American citizens. That is essentially what the FBI does. The Federal Bureau of Investigation is an agency that's designed to gather intelligence about threats to American citizens from within the United States. It's designed to enforce federal law. So we have an agency that already is in place to do that, and in fact can do a very, very good job at that. It used to be that the peak of militias, of violent extremist groups and militias in the United States was in 1996. And after the Oklahoma City bombing, the FBI was very effective in infiltrating far-right groups and essentially disbanding them.
Barbara Walter, thank you.
My pleasure.
The recent threats of civil war among radicalized Trump supporters are not isolated. 5 years ago today, white supremacists and neo-Nazis marched on Charlottesville, Virginia, in a violent demonstration. We visited the city to see what's changed and to ask residents if they think the country has fully reckoned with what it witnessed that summer. And a warning, this story contains violent images that may be disturbing to some viewers.
This is where I saw a group come by. They were all young men wearing white tops and khaki pants.
On the morning of August 12, 2017, Diane Hillman watched from the steps of Congregation Beth Israel as white supremacists marched. Her synagogue, the only one in the city, had just finished its Saturday Sabbath service.
They said, oh, there's the synagogue. And then they started yelling the traditional anti-Semitic, blood and soil, Jews will not replace us.
Scores of self-proclaimed neo-Nazis, white supremacists, and far-right militiamen under the name Unite the Right had gathered to protest the removal of a Confederate statue in town and to demonstrate the power of the alt-right movement.
This is what you represent!
It quickly turned violent and ultimately fatal when one neo-Nazi drove his car through a crowd of demonstrators, killing 32-year-old Heather Heyer. Today, residents are still looking for accountability, a process met with fits and starts.
I hope that we can move to an authentic healing by embracing truth.
New city leadership, including the first black female mayor and the creation of a police civilian oversight board, were stymied by bureaucracy and turnover. A lack of trust remains between law enforcement and the community. For the synagogue, it's meant new security.
Some of the Unite the Right rally leaders were seen many times across the street watching the synagogue. And so as a result, we've had to fortify our synagogue, mostly in ways that are not obvious.
Did you have a guard before?
No, we never had a guard before.
And there are mixed feelings on the city's progress.
I had hoped that the Unite the Right rally would light a fire and urge Charlottesville to become a model. And I think we still have that hope, but I don't think we're there yet.
The problems extend beyond the city, argues Jelaine Schmidt, an activist and professor at the University of Virginia.
People in Charlottesville felt abandoned by government at every level, you know, in the wake of Unite the Right, like we weren't protected.
Has that trauma fully healed?
No. No.
Jews will not replace us! Jews!
By the time the alt-right carried torches across the UVA lawn, Schmidt had already confronted them at a July Ku Klux Klan rally. The chaos on the 12th was no surprise to her and others, even as the violence and former President Trump's response stunned the nation.
But you also had people that were very fine people on both sides.
The people of Charlottesville are still grappling with the trauma of August 12th and of that entire summer. They call it the Summer of Hate. And where I'm standing is where neo-Nazis and white supremacists march. Trump's response and the violence here is what ultimately catalyzed Joe Biden to run for president.
Charlottesville, Virginia, that moment, I knew the threat to this nation was unlike any I had ever seen in my lifetime.
Charlottesville, the first word in President Biden's announcement video, a rallying cry on the campaign trail, and a promise in his inaugural address.
Now, a rise of political extremism, white supremacy, domestic terrorism, that we must confront and we will defeat.
But in a city that voted for him by more than 70 points, residents we talked to want to see more.
I don't think he's done anything.
I couldn't tell you like what in particular he has done, like what decisive actions he has taken.
If someone is kind of going to kind of attach their, you know, name to, you know, Charlottesville, this attack on Charlottesville is what inspired them. You know, I invite them to, you know, to listen to the some of the goals that our community has articulated in the aftermath of Unite the Right.
Hillman acknowledged the difficulty of the task.
He stepped into an almost undoable job. And there's nothing Joe Biden can do about that. It's got to come out of Congress.
But the administration can do more, argues Cynthia Miller Idris, a professor and extremism expert at American University.
The Biden administration did produce the first ever domestic strategy to counter domestic terrorism. But I will say that since then, that's 14 months ago, we've seen almost nothing in terms of implementation.
On steps forward in terms of action, are there policies that President Biden has not pursued that you think would make a difference?
In that first national strategy, the Biden administration promised that there would be, they suggested and said that there would be efforts to reach out to the Department of Education, to Health and Human Services, to a broader array of actors. That may be happening behind the scenes, but we haven't seen any of that happen yet.
The White House says they are working across agencies, pointing to a new mental health hotline with tactics to detect threats of violence, investments in digital literacy tools to combat disinformation, bipartisan legislation on hate crimes reporting, and a team focused on domestic terrorism at the National Security Council.
We heard the chants.
President Biden often references Charlottesville in speeches, as he did when visiting Buffalo, New York this spring, after a shooter motivated by racism killed 10 people.
When I saw those people coming out of the woods in Charlottesville, carrying torches, shouting, "You will not replace us."
His senior advisor, Mike Donilon, said the president thinks about Charlottesville every day. He told NewsHour, "One of the most important roles the president plays is a constant and forceful and vigilant voice against extremism and white supremacy and the forces of hate in the country. His voice is the loudest and biggest microphone." Even as some of the groups behind Unite the Right declined, the racist great replacement theory that motivated them flourished, inspiring mass shootings, including the massacre in Buffalo. And on January 6, 2021, some of the same people who marched in downtown Charlottesville stormed the United States Capitol.
Where in Charlottesville, these groups on the far right tried to unite, but they failed. But on January 6th, they did show that you could get white supremacists and militia groups and QAnon supporters and conspiracy theorists and ordinary Trump voters together on the lowest common denominator, which was election disinformation, and they could have a successful violent action.
To those in Charlottesville, the parallels were unmistakable.
Do you see a direct line from the neo-Nazi march and attack on Charlottesville to January 6th?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Ultimately, Schmidt isn't looking to the White House for leadership. Her focus is local.
Our position was and is not on our watch, you know, never again.
That starts with honestly documenting what happened. At UVA, Schmidt helped install the No Unity Without Justice special exhibit.
There are new students coming in to the University of Virginia student body, first-year students who now have no memory of this having occurred.
On display, counter-protesting guides and tear gas canisters from encounters between police and activists.
These are, you know, some of their demands.
In response, UVA made changes to the curriculum and agreed to pay the medical bills of people injured that summer in an amount equal to a 1921 pledge to the university by the KKK. Many demands remain unfulfilled, but last year, the city met one critical commitment, removing the statue of Confederate General Robert E. Lee.
Lee Park is on the left.
Diane Hillman showed us the walk from the synagogue to the park, a reminder of what she saw on August 12th.
It's a very different feeling here today, right now, compared to what it was. It just feels so peaceful now.
An empty plot remains where Lee's statue once stood as the city considers what to do next. And on this anniversary, clergy and community members will walk from here to Heather Heyer Way in remembrance of what happened and in defiance of the forces they're still fighting. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Laura Barone Lopez in Charlottesville, Virginia.
This past weekend, European, Iranian, and American negotiators flew to Vienna to see if they could once and for all come to an agreement over Iran's nuclear program. The Biden administration has been negotiating to re-enter a deal from which the Trump administration withdrew. Nick Schifrin updates us on the talks and speaks to the chief U.S. negotiator.
Since its first day in office, the Biden administration has argued the best way to prevent Iran from obtaining a nuclear weapon is through diplomacy, instead of through the Trump administration's strategy known as maximum pressure. For a year and a half, European and Iranian negotiators have met in Vienna for more than 8 rounds, with the U.S. participating indirectly, to try and find an agreement where the U.S. and Iran would return to compliance with the 2015 nuclear deal. The U.S. would lift hundreds of sanctions the Trump administration reimposed when it withdrew from the deal in 2018. And Iran would roll back its nuclear program to the limits set by the original nuclear deal, including caps on enrichment and how much material it can stockpile. The Europeans now say there is a final text on the table, and to discuss whether that could lead to a deal, I'm joined by Rob Malley, the U.S. Special Envoy for Iran. Rob Malley, welcome back to the NewsHour. Let's lay out some of the progress you've made with Iran so far. Do you believe you have an agreement on the sanctions that the U.S. would lift in exchange for the steps that Iran would take in order to get back its nuclear program into compliance?
There's no agreement because nothing is agreed until everything is agreed. There's a text. There's a very clear sense about what the European Union, the coordinator, thinks needs to be in the text for there to be a mutual return to compliance. And our position has been clear, as you said, from day one. We're prepared to come back into compliance with the nuclear deal if Iran does the same. And for us, it's very clear what that means in terms of the sanctions relief we need to offer and the kind of steps that Iran needs to take to roll back its nuclear program.
Iran is asking for a concession outside the deal, and that has to do with the International Atomic Energy Agency's investigation into nuclear material found in Iran, which the IAEA says Iran has not provided adequate explanations for. Iran is asking for that investigation to be lifted or somehow to be solved. Is the U.S. going to give any concessions when it comes to that investigation?
No. And again, we've made this clear, and I know there's been some reporting to the contrary. Our position is transparent, and it's clear for everyone to hear, which is we're not going to put any pressure on the International Atomic Energy Agency to close these outstanding issues. They will be closed when Iran provides the technically credible answers that the IAEA, the International Atomic Energy Agency, has requested of them. As soon as they do that, and as soon as the agency is satisfied, we will be satisfied, but not before.
Is there any kind of political agreement, perhaps not a technical agreement, but a political agreement that could be made, frankly, that Iran believes was made for the last nuclear deal, in which this investigation into prior Iranian steps could not prevent a deal that you're talking about now?
We think there's a safeguards, those outstanding issues, nuclear issues, that Iran has to explain the presence of uranium particles that have not been explained. And really what the agency is interested in is not so much sort of a prehistorical or historical exploration. What they want to know is, where is that uranium today? And make sure that it's accounted for and that it's under what is called safeguards. That's what the agency is particularly interested in, and so it needs to hear from Iran an explanation of where these uranium particles are and make sure that they are under IAEA safeguards. There's no shortcut.
Is the U.S. making any concession at all that would allow non-Americans to do business with the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps and get around, essentially, U.S. sanctions?
We would not, and have not and will not, negotiate any lowering of our standards about what European or other companies need to do if they want to do business with Iran. They have to respect our sanctions. The sanctions are very well defined. The Treasury Department puts out very clear standards for what companies need to do, what kind of due diligence they need to do. And any report to the contrary that is claiming that we will lower those standards, that we will negotiate those standards, are just flat out wrong.
On sanctions relief, how much relief would Iran get? One analysis by an organization that, of course, opposes you re-entering the deal says Iran would gain access to tens of billions of dollars of central bank assets that are currently frozen and be able to sell tens of billions of dollars more of oil.
Well, I'm not going to give you a number because that would be highly speculative, but I can say there are assets that have been frozen, assets, money that Iran collected at a time when the sanctions were not in place, and that are now in bank accounts across the globe. They would be able to have access to those if they come back into compliance with the nuclear deal. And of course, they'd be able to sell oil, which they're not able to do now, and to get the proceeds from the sale of oil. But again, let's remember why those sanctions were put in place. Those sanctions were put in place to get Iran to agree to curb its nuclear program and to make sure that Iran cannot acquire a nuclear weapon. And we've lived the opposite. It's not a thought experiment. For the last several years, since President Trump decided to withdraw from the deal, we've seen Iran with an unconstrained nuclear program and with a more aggressive regional behavior. So that experiment has failed.
The constraints that Iran agreed to in the Iranian nuclear deal, the original 2015 deal, include sunsets. One of the first major sunsets are in 2023, after which they would be allowed to manufacture advanced centrifuges. Why is a deal worth it still today, even though that sunset, when it comes to manufacturing advanced centrifuges, is only a year away?
So first of all, that's not precisely what happens in 2023. They can do more research and development on some advanced centrifuges. They cannot install them. But let's put it this way. The main constraint, which is a constraint that puts Iran several months away from having enough fissile material for one bomb, that would last until 2031. The situation we're in today, as a result of the decision to withdraw from the deal, is Iran is only a handful of weeks away from having enough fissile material for a bomb. So again, we have to compare this to the reality we're living today. If we could get a deal that would put Iran back several months away from being able to have enough fissile material for a bomb.
The Europeans have said this is the final deal. Is it?
What the European Union has said, and they're the coordinator, is that they believe that negotiations over this text have exhausted their usefulness and don't see that they could be improved through continued talks. We're considering the text very carefully to make sure that it lives up to the president's very clear guidance that he would only sign up to a deal that is consistent with U.S. national security interests.
The Department of Justice this week charged a member of the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps of plotting to assassinate former national security advisor John Bolton. Is the threat of Iranian attempts to assassinate former senior officials for the assassination of Qasem Soleimani, the former IRGC Quds Force heads, is that threat ongoing? And do you fear it will last for a while?
So I'm not going to comment on the work that the Department of Justice has done. I think it speaks for itself. But I would repeat what both the Secretary of State and the National Security Advisor have said, which is that this president, as I assume any president, will be relentless in protecting Americans, whether they are in or out of uniform, whether they are current or former officials. And on this, I think we stand united. And I think Iran has gotten the message that if it threatens our citizens, we will respond decisively.
Rob Malley, Special Envoy for Iran, thank you very much.
Thank you.
The press, politicians, and the public are struggling to untangle a knot of questions, new and old, following the unprecedented FBI search of a former president's home earlier this week. Which leads us to the analysis of Brooks and Capehart. That's New York Times columnist David Brooks and Jonathan Capehart, associate editor for The Washington Post. Hello to both of you. It's Friday night. Good to have you with us again. And there's one story that's dominating the news today. Jonathan, I'm going to start with you. I hardly know where to begin, but what do you make of this? I mean, the FBI carted off 11 boxes, we're learning, of various degrees of confidential material this week.
My head is still spinning. And not just any material. Some of the material we now know from the released warrant have to have either classified markings, top secret markings, or sensitive compartmented information, which is probably the highest level of security intelligence documents there are. You can only read those in secure locations, and they're not meant to be taken out of those secured locations. But Judy, I'm trying to look at this not from a partisan lens, not from my particular perspective as someone, you know, center and left, but as just an American, taking out the name of the person involved, we have just seen a former president of the United States be subpoenaed in June for documents, ignored the subpoena. The FBI gets a search warrant based on three aspects of the Espionage Act. They wait 3 days to execute it. They execute that search warrant against a former president of the United States. And now we're learning that some of the most sensitive information a government official can have access to, he had with him more than a year after being out of office at his private residence.
What should we make of
under this? Normal?
Oh, under I'm sorry. I thought you were stopping. Go ahead, Jonathan.
No, I'm just going to say, under normal circumstances, everything should be on fire because we should not be in this situation. No president has done this. No president should do this. But Donald Trump did.
Yeah, when I first heard about it, I have to confess my stomach sank. And my reaction was, does the FBI understand the political firestorm they're about to set off? As the days have gone by, the gravity of what the FBI did and the justification for what they did have grown. And so first we learned this was not a rash thing, that it's been months in the making. They did issue a subpoena. They walked through this step by step. And then even the last few hours, we've learned that, as Jonathan said, if these documents are top secret documents, the people who know more about this than I, that they say that's a really big deal. And one of the acts the president is being investigated for is the Espionage Act. This is a serious act which, you know, could be a decade in prison for a normal human being. And there are other acts, but the potential falsification and mutilation of documents, that's also years in prison. And so these are not small crimes. These are major criminal if they get to it, accusations. And if you have that kind of crime and you're a law enforcement officer, you know, you got to do something.
Jonathan, how much of this depends on what actually was in those documents? How secret, how confidential, how explosive that material was?
Well, I think that sort of gradation depends on what potential charges could come down the road. But we're still talking about documents that should never have left the White House, should be in the possession of the National Archives, because they are the official custodian of presidential records. There are laws to ensure that those records go to the National Archives. No president, no former president should have the documents that Donald Trump had before the FBI took them out, out of Mar-a-Lago. So that's what we should be focused on. That, to my mind, yes, it matters what's in the documents. What's even more important is that he took them against statutes once he left the White House. I cannot express how serious this situation is that the country finds itself in right now.
David, you started a minute ago by saying initially you had this sinking feeling that this could lead to sympathy, greater support for former President Trump. How much is that still something that's a concern?
Yeah, no, I do think this is, both things are true. The FBI was probably right to do what they did. This will help Donald Trump. And it helps Donald Trump in a number of ways. First, as a number of his potential primary opponents, consultants have been saying off the record in the media, their campaigns are now have the air taken out of their sails. A couple months ago, half of all Republicans were saying they want to move on. Now, in the last week, at least, and maybe short term, last week, the whole party is rallying around Donald Trump. 80% of Republicans say they're more motivated to vote in 2022 because of what they call this raid. The vast majority are saying this is not an impartial investigation. This is a political hack job, something like 75%. Half of all Americans believe that. And so you get this situation where people are rallying around Trump. His opponents now have little to run on because everyone's defending the guy who's been attacked. And then here's where I get to the nightmare scenario. What happens if in a year or two from now, Donald Trump is cruising to the Republican nomination because he's winning primary after primary, and he gets convicted of something? What happens if a year and a half from now, the American public decides he's going to be elected president, and the American legal system decides, oh no, he's going to prison? What happens then to our country? Because I assume he has to be arrested, and I assume half the country is just going to erupt in rage and, frankly, political violence. So this is the presupposition for all this. We live in a society where there's incredibly low social trust, so people don't trust the institutions. And B, in a normal party, your candidacy is hurt if you're investigated by the FBI. That is not the current Republican Party right now, at least right now. And so this is, you can see down the road to a potential where our legal system and our political system crash and society is really disrupted.
And Jonathan, it it's not even having a charge leveled against the former president. I mean, just this week, this man went after the FBI in Cincinnati. He was later killed. He was somebody involved in January 6th. He's a very, very strong Trump believer. How much do you think the former president is helped by this politically, as David is saying, and how worried are you about it leading to something else?
Oh, Donald Trump is absolutely helped by this. The people who believe in Donald Trump and love Donald Trump will believe everything that he says and believe that anything that is done, quote unquote, against him is persecuting him and therefore persecuting them. I do not think that fear of potential violence or fear of whatever political benefit could come to Donald Trump should factor into the wheels of justice turning. He cannot be allowed to be above the law. And if the Justice Department or the wheels of justice were to cower in the face of the potential of benefiting him, then our democracy is lost. He must be held accountable just like anyone else potentially accused or investigated tried for or found guilty of the things that we're talking about right now. Just because he was a sitting president, a former president of the United States, does not mean he's above the law. And if, let's say that crash happens that David is talking about, and he's elected, but he's convicted, well, he won't be president of the United States. Judy, David, I am so concerned about where we are right now because we are in uncharted territory. We don't know what the charges are going to be, what the real impact is going to be. I do agree with David, however, that anything that happens negative from Trump and Trump supporters' perspective is going to lead to things that I don't think we're prepared for, but we must get prepared for it because our democracy is on the line.
David, should any of this worry about what this could lead to affect the judicial process in any way?
Yeah, I absolutely think it should. We're all responsible for the consequences of our actions. And prosecutors and investigators use discretion every single day. And so if they're indicting a candidate for a major party, my own personal opinion is the bar should be pretty high, that they really, it's a very serious crime, and B, it's a very crystal clear case that the whole country can see. That doesn't mean and as the experts of even the last few hours have talked about what Donald Trump may have done with these documents, probably clears the bar. January 6th, I became more to think it clears the bar. But you just can't ignore the society around you. You can't ignore a society that is in perilously close danger of rupturing. And does that determine what you do? Do you let somebody get away with a major crime? Obviously not. But you can, and none of us can be blind to the consequences of our actions. And I think prosecutors are comfortable with that.
What about that, Jonathan?
Well, I don't disagree with David. I do think that the facts as we know them now in terms of that FBI search, that high bar was there and that the Justice Department cleared those bars and then some because they understand the consequences of what they're going to do and the public reaction, knowing that the subpoena was issued in June and ignored, that they got the search warrant 3 days
right
before it was executed. That to me says that the Justice Department and those people are exercising extreme caution and care.
Just a little bit of time left, but I do want to ask you both about more election results this week, David. It's the election deniers who are doing well in so many of these primary contests, and in race after race, they seem to be the folks Donald Trump has endorsed.
Yeah, I'd say in some weeks we've had a mixed bag that some non-Trump people did well, but pretty much in the recent ones, Arizona, Wisconsin, elsewhere, Trump people more or less swept the field. The election, I can't remember if it was the day before or after the House raid, I can't remember if it was affected by it, but they had a very good, and then progressives did pretty well. And so I would say the overall story from all these primaries so far is increased polarization.
Jonathan, less than a minute. What does this set up November to look like?
a wild November, Judy. But the thing that I'm looking at is, we now have 5 Republican gubernatorial candidates across the country who are election deniers: Arizona, Wisconsin, Michigan, Illinois, Maryland, and Pennsylvania. Any one of them, if they actually become governor of their particular state, the 2024 presidential election is in deep trouble.
Well, on this light note that we're ending on this Friday night.
Another sober week in politics.
Jonathan Capehart, David Brooks, thank you. Thank you both.
Thank you. Thanks, Judy.
And on the News Hour, as we wrap up the program, online right now, the Inflation Reduction Act could reshape the energy landscape in the U.S. You can read more about how it aims to put more fossil fuel alternatives within reach for consumers and for the industry at large. That's on our website, pbs.org/newshour. And don't forget to join moderator Yamiche Alcindor and her Washington Week panel for more analysis of the Mar-a-Lago search and to hear about a reporter's 18-month investigation into the Trump administration's family separation policy. That's tonight on PBS. And tune into PBS News Weekend on Saturday to see how one teenage Afghan refugee who fled the Taliban regime last year is pursuing her dream to be a musician. And that's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you. Please stay safe, and we will see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by Economy for 160 years. BNSF, the engine that connects us. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the NewsHour, including Kathy and Paul Anderson, and Camilla and George Smith. The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. For more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world at Hewlett.org.
Supporting social entrepreneurs and their solutions to the world's most pressing problems. SkollFoundation.org.
And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.